Skip Sabian said, I look forward to seeing that. Nigga, I look forward to seeing you and everybody in this segment walking out the door for the last time, never to be seen again. Zero rain.
I'm liking the women's division, especially New Japan, because now they're getting actual firepower. Plus, they're actually wrestling.
Best friends, still employed. Troy Peretta, still employed. Chuck Taylor, still employed. Dan Housen, still fucking employed. Get them out of here.
This is ridiculous. This is. Where is the logic in this? Where is the logic? Somebody find it. And when you find it, give it to Tony Khan.
Let's open Radio Rogue Break.
Hey guys, Habanate here, and today we're back for another episode of Life's Opening Radio Rogue Break. And today we're going to review WrestleMania 39, Night 1. A very big show, and I've got here Josh Jenkins and Ben Charles, who unfortunately is experiencing technical issues. We can't hear him. We're going to talk about some things, and Ben will just have to type out his thoughts because we can't hear him. You guys know Ben. He hosts the Mysteries of Life Season 3, Episode 1, which is out right now. I listened to it, and it's pretty good. I like the new format of it, and I look forward to hearing more and seeing who are the guests on this season. So, since I've introduced... by the way, Ben, thank you for hosting with me Overload 3, which will be out when this is out. I don't know with Ben's current situation if he'll be able to record the rest of it with me. We might have to make a plan or something, try to record tomorrow. Fingers crossed that his stuff does work tomorrow and next week when we review Night 2. Josh, would you like to introduce yourself?
I don't have to, but since you've asked. I'm Josh. You know me now as the guest host on here. I used to be full-time, but now I'm not. But I don't need to go over that right now. So let's just skip past that. I host my own radio program, which this is basically linked to, called Life's Opening Radio. I have my own YouTube channel. Well, I have channels. Josh Times 3, my own personal YouTube channel for the vlogs and videos such as those. I have a gaming channel for, you know, games, you know, and called I think Triple J Extra or something.
Yeah,
I'll have to check.
I think you also called it Triple J Gaming.
I have to check on that. Hey, how come I don't know the name of my own channel? What is going on? But that's me. And series 3, episode 1 of The Mysteries of Life is called From the Heavens Above, which obviously isn't the case for Ben right now.
Yeah.
Technology wise today.
Ben is in the technological hell below. Yeah, it's ridiculous. But yeah, speaking of hell, we're going to talk about some people who probably... not right, but they are not right themselves. And this person, or these people, the first person is wrestling legend Rick Steiner, who used transphobic slurs towards Impact Wrestling star Giselle Shaw. This is from Bounding Into Comics, written by Jacob Smith. I'll just read from here. A male to female transgender individual who currently competes in Impact Wrestling's women's division, Shaw claimed that on the 31st of March, coincidentally the same date as International Transgender Day of Visibility. Quickly tap out your thoughts on this if you aren't already. This is so fucked up. She says, I was at an autograph signing event today at WrestleCon, and while I was walking to my table, I hear someone yelling, you're a man, you're a dude, you're a piece of trash, you are filth, get the fuck away from here. I kept my head down and kept walking as I did not want to acknowledge that hate, the wrestler further recalled. When I arrived to my table, I spoke to another Impact Wrestling talent who was at the signing with me and mentioned the incident. It didn't sit well with me, and I wanted to know who was saying that because it's unacceptable. So I decided to take a walk in that area, and I hear that same person saying the same derogatory comments. According to Shaw, it was then that she supposedly discovered that the one shouting insults was none other than WWE Hall of Famer and one half of the legendary Steiner Brothers tag team, Rick Steiner. I was shocked and could not believe that this was even happening. To have someone saying these comments who a lot of people look up to and consider their hero was quite shocking and disheartening. I was in disbelief, so I asked him, excuse me? He kept repeating those hateful phrases and started yelling me in a public setting. It was inexcusable and unacceptable. Another disappointing part about this whole incident was that there were other wrestling legends who just sat there, turned their heads away, did not want to get involved or stand up for what's right because it involved one of the boys, she continued. Judging from that experience, it was more important for them to watch something wrong go down as opposed to standing up for someone who's being bullied and doing what's right. I'm not writing this because I want sympathy, Shaw then clarified. I'm writing this because I'm being bullied to silence. Today is International Transgender Day of Visibility, and I'm standing up for myself and for other people who go through the exact same situation on a daily basis. I want everyone to know what kind of a deplorable person Rick Steiner is, and that this cannot be tolerated. This keeps happening because people let it slide and do not take any action. If you do business with these types of people, then I will not do business with you. Drawing her statement to a close, the wrestler declared, I want to thank all my Impact peers who were present during the incident and tried to defuse the situation. Unfortunately, a member of that same peer group was also verbally accosted by Rick Steiner, being called the F word early in the day, and concluded. I'm very fortunate to be working alongside such incredible people in a company that has no room for hate, bullying, or judgment. We're not just co-workers, but a family. Yeah, I'm just scrolling down. Yeah, man, this is just complete idiocy. And Ben says about the Rick Steiner situation, I used to like Rick Steiner, and now I've lost all full respect for this fucking goon. If these are true, he needs his Hall of Fame ring gone, his legacy erased and deleted. This man shall not walk the streets anywhere knowing this man is an embarrassment. I don't care about his in-ring work, and I never did. The only time he was a draw was because he was a tag team with his brother Scott Steiner. As said, much worse, but that does not mean call Giselle Shaw a dude. I don't care who you are. Do not call a woman a dude. And I hope Rick Steiner gets cussed out and embarrassed by every single fan of in the wrestling community. Get him the fuck out of here. I'm in all support of Giselle Shaw because she deserves it. And yeah, I actually didn't know that Giselle Shaw was trans. I think she was on NXT UK once. She used to be on NXT UK. And yeah, I hope she recovers from this incident and that Rick Steiner doesn't get away with it, and that he gets the necessary punishment. He hasn't said anything, it appears, but yeah, this ain't very good. Josh, what are your thoughts?
Well, I can accept him being punished for his very negative views on this. I'm not surprised that he would have these views, considering most people from his era when he grew up kind of saw things this way. Not everyone, you know, thankfully, but obviously he's one of them, sadly. Yeah, being transphobic isn't, and it shouldn't be accepted in today's society, especially in the decades to come, where being trans should be seen as more viable.
Yeah.
In terms of human rights and morality. I just hope this doesn't affect Braun Breaker, because Rick is his uncle or his father, one of them.
Yeah.
So I hope Braun Breaker doesn't share these views to begin with, and I hope he doesn't get punished for what his uncle or father thinks.
Did. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's one thing that I almost forgot to mention, is that this could hurt, possibly, curtail Braun Breaker's run right now, because they've been putting him in a high position ever since he came into NXT, and now he might get his push halted because of something his uncle is out of touch. Uncle said, and never mind, we'll get to that now. But another one of these people who aren't right is, and Ben says Carmelo Hayes is NXT champion. Oh shit, really? You see why, bro? Oh, when did he lose the belt?
No idea.
Standing
alone.
Shit. That was WrestleMania weekend. Wow.
I believe that was a few hours before
WrestleMania
started. Yeah.
Yeah, but oh my. That's sad. That is sad. Now, you see, it's already happened. It's already happening now. All because of these comments, Bron Breakker is getting his push halted and curtailed. So I think maybe Bron Breakker should have denounced his uncle's comments. And maybe then that would have made him look a bit better in the eyes of fans, because I'm sure even he hasn't said anything, but I think some fans would not like Bron Breakker because of what his uncle said. But anyway, let's go on to the next topic, which is been quite big recently, and we'll get to some bigger news just now. Vicky, this is from Ringside News. Written by Felix Upton, and it says here, this is Vicky Guerrero. Her daughter Sherilyn put out some allegations that her stepfather sexually assaulted her on a cruise. And this is what Vicky Guerrero said. There are two sides to a story. Over 15 years, my relationship with Sherilyn has been hostile, and have tried to deal with a narcissist person. Not only myself, but close friends of Sherilyn over 10 years and family have cut ties with her because of her manic behaviors. I tried to do therapy with Sherilyn, but she always said no and that I am sick, not her. Sherilyn, please tell your side of your character of being drunk on the cruise and having guys in your room, then crying because you think you were raped, and then demanded us to go to a pharmacy in Bahamas for Plan B. You want to play dirty and sling Chris and I through the mud? I have my own pile of mud from you. Are you enjoying the two cars that Chris brought you, the three apartments that you bailed out of, and the two surgeries we paid for you? Your lies will catch up, and I feel bad for you. Sherilyn, not once have you spoken to Chris about this situation, but you can go on social media and tell all. But that's how you communicate. Another example of you manipulating and harassing others. I'm so done with you and tired of the years of your manipulation, lies, and disrespect. I kept quiet for years because you never seek therapy to learn how to have an adult conversation with me. It always has been your way or nothing at all. Okay, Sherilyn, not only will I see you in court, but you and I will no longer be related. For the fans who feel entitled to comment, fuck you. You hear one side of a story and you feel entitled to comment on something you know nothing about. And that's pretty wild statement from Vicky Guerrero. Well, I don't know about not saying anything. You should say something. Because you do have the right to say when something's wrong and someone's hurt you. Ben says that Vicky Guerrero is wrong for talking about social media. They should have hashed it out most behindly and dealt with it behind closed doors. I agree that, I don't agree with Vicky Guerrero. It seems from most people, Chavo Guerrero and Shaul. And, I just unplugged my mic quickly.
Because it was tangled.
Is my mic back? Hopefully it is. Okay. I don't agree with with Vicky because, you know, it's one thing to defend your husband, but to defend a sexual assailant is something else that is not right entirely. And a lot of people have lost respect for her. As I was about to say, sorry, sir. See, this statement is such bullshit that I'm yawning so much. Chavo and Shaul Guerrero have come in support of Sherilyn, so I guess I'm only guessing. I don't know for sure. I'm guessing that Sherilyn is in the right. So yeah, I hope she gets justice. And if she is lying, that I don't know, man. It's just such a weird situation. Josh, what are your thoughts?
I don't have any, which might come as a surprise, but look, yeah, I don't have anything to say about it. I just hope that this doesn't extend any further than it needs to. And yeah, I don't support sexual assault under any circumstances. It doesn't matter who does it. It doesn't matter who does it. The fact that it would happen or not is what matters more than who is the one who is doing it or not. I'm just gonna move on.
Yeah. And have you heard? I'm sure you guys have heard. Apparently, the WWE and the UFC have made some kind of deal. They're gonna have a thing with Endeavor. Vince has sold it, and Ben, it's interesting. And Ben says here, and Vince apparently is that Vince seems to have, you know, taken the helm again. He seemed to have booked the Raw after WrestleMania, which has mostly negative reviews. Ben says that he doesn't agree with Vince being in creative again. Vince needs to get out. He's an asshole and most importantly a jackass. And that Raw after WrestleMania was one of the worst Raws of all time. And apparently there's a threat that he's gonna book SmackDown as well. So now that show is in jeopardy. Well, from the roundup, I'm hearing SmackDown hasn't been that good anyway. Josh, what are your thoughts on this whole thing?
Well, I mean, quite simply, Vince McMahon needs to get future endeavored. I somewhatly respect the sale, but him being in charge of creative in any way at all, I do not respect. He said he would not touch creative. He said he was only going to be back in power just to make the sale happen, and then he would leave. But another lie from the liar himself.
Yeah.
Vince lies all the time. He says he won't have anything to do with SmackDown. I guarantee you he'll have everything to do with SmackDown. He said he wouldn't get in the weeds, otherwise meaning the creative, in the interview that he did. And then what happened? He planted the weeds. He planted the seeds on Raw. And apparently he had some influence on night two of WrestleMania, which, thinking back to it, it did feel very off compared to night one. So that's probably true. Yeah, as you may know, I do not like Vince McMahon and his creative over the past decade or even two decades or even since he took charge in 1982. I don't support Vince, especially because of the misconduct that happened last year. I don't understand why he even is allowed to force his way back into power, but whatever. Hopefully justice is served to him at some point, because it has to. Jesus. I want Vince gone. I want Triple H in charge, even though I'm not liking Triple H's creative vision completely. But he is much better than Vince's, so I will take that over Vince any flipping day of the year. So I think it was about 21 billion combined. I think WWE was sold for $9.3 billion, which is a shock, because I think the estimated value of the company as a whole was around 6 billion. So for Vince to sell it like 3.3 billion more than what it's actually worth is quite a shock. But Vince is very determined. He's a very determined business individual. He always has been. I'm hoping that Ari Emanuel, who is the Endeavor person, has the balls to remove Vince from CEO or whatever the position is that Vince has now, because he does have the authority to remove Vince now. So, oh, and this is the first time that I can think of that Vince actually has a boss. Vince has an actual boss above him. That is wild to think about. That is wild. But I'm hoping Vince goes sooner than later. Because why the heck would anybody want to keep him around? He's done what he came to do. He sold the company. Now get rid of him. Goodbye, Vince. Please go away. So yeah, that's my thoughts. I hope UFC doesn't I hope the UFC roster doesn't show up on the WWE roster, because I just don't think that's going to mix very well. But that's me.
Yeah, and Ben has another thing. Vince did not have to sell the company. Triple H and Stephanie were not going to sell the company, and they didn't even want to. You can tell by the way they did business and by how things worked after Vince was gone. Vince should be in jail, but he's not. Vince should be also out of creative. He's not. He said Raw last week was god-awful. These people had the audacity to open the show with Omos versus Elias. Get them both off my TV. Monday Night Raw needs to be at 2 hours, but it won't, because these people don't know what they're doing. This shit is get off my TV material for a reason. And yeah, that's Ben's additional thoughts on this whole situation. And yeah,
I'll sure. Sure, I just want to add on there. Even though I do respect the sale, The only reason that is because it provides the company a lot more money than they previously had. And that means they can not have to worry so much about, you know, the budget of the company or the roster salary or like enough money to pay for pyro and the venue costs and, you know, all of that stuff. So having more money actually helps to progress the company forward in so many different ways. But yeah, I am surprised at the same time that the sale did happen, considering Vince was never very keen, or he never really had the idea to begin with to sell the company, because it's a family orientated business. Well, I say that, but Vince doesn't really see Stephanie or Shane as those to take the succession of the company forward, because Vince wants to be the sole owner. He wants to be the sole authoritarian. I think that's the word.
Yeah.
Vince is Vince. I respect the sale, even though I don't at the same time, but the positive is that it now provides a lot more money to the company, which can help in so many different ways. But yeah, Vince has to go. He has to go. And I don't know how many times I can continue to say that, really. So I'll say it one last time. Vince has to go. He's done. Retire. He said he retired last year, but then he didn't. He faked it. Fuck me, man.
Yeah. Anyways, we got one more thing, or actually a few things.
Okay.
My gosh. Just nonstop news here. Yeah. There was a whole, Ben's favorite wrestler, Dominic Mysterio, had a video package at WrestleMania.
What?
And apparently, it had Auschwitz photo in it. And, they got roasted for that. So while Ben types out his thoughts, I will read this article by Sean Reuter. From Cage Side Seats. He said here, one version of WrestleMania 39's video package for the Rey vs. Dominic Mysterio program was called out for using an image of Poland's Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum. The museum is part of a memorial to the million plus people, the vast majority of whom were Jews killed at concentration and extermination camps operated there during the Nazi occupation of the country during World War II. Here the Auschwitz Museum tweeted, the fact that an Auschwitz image was used to promote a WWE match is hard to call an editing mistake. Exploiting the site that became a symbol of enormous human tragedy is shameless and insults the memory of all victims of Auschwitz. This is not great from the WWE. I don't condone that either. Using a site like Auschwitz to promote a WWE match, much less, whatever. Ben just says here simply, WWE swung and missed badly, unless he has more to say, but until then, it says here, it sounds like a Vince decision, probably is. But Josh, what do you think about this?
Yeah, just Dominic has spent time in prison. Yeah, he spent time in prison. I have not liked this storyline since he turned heel at the Clash at the Castle pay-per-view. It never made sense for him to turn to begin with. And yet he did. And now he spent...
This episode of Rope Break is interrupted to advertise Lux Open Radio certified bangers. A roller coaster of music consisting of drum and bass. Indie pop. Gobble's mind, as well as world news and special guests. You can listen to Lux Open Radio certified bangers every Sunday afternoon on Spotify. Back to your regular scheduled programming. Back now, had some problems. I don't know what the fuck is going on today, and nothing's working. Josh, if you're still there, it seems to have frozen again. Could you please repeat?
Oh my god.
Okay, well, I can hear you now. So now that I can hear you, I can see you, you're not freezing or anything, could you please repeat your thoughts on Dominic?
Okay, I'll just say the whole thing again. They used that imagery to promote the characterization of Dominic's character now, because he spent time in prison, so they have to use imagery to promote the fact that his character has spent time in prison, which is absolute nonsense, because it doesn't make any sense for him to have spent time in prison, even though there is some sense to it in the storyline, I suppose. But, no, I haven't really liked Dom as a character since he turned heel at Clash of the Castle last September, when it never made any sense for that to even happen. And now he spent time in prison and they have to characterize him as such. So they used... I don't know... They could have used any other prison imagery to promote his characterization. Why did they have to specifically select that one? I do not know. But here we are. This is the situation that they came to find themselves in because they put themselves into this situation.
Yeah.
So yeah. Hopefully this will end the characterization that Dom has spent time in prison. Yeah. It's nonsense.
Yeah, nobody believes in it except the people that like Dominic. Ben says, which prison did Dom go to? Leavenworth, East River Penitentiary, Fox River Penitentiary, that's a special one. Ben doesn't know which prison Dom went to, and you can see Ben going off there. You can't hear him though. Y'all know what Ben thinks of Dominic if you listen to the roundups. He's been absolutely going ham on him. Oh boy.
Did Dominic spend time in the Rat? The Spider-Man based prison?
Well, he'd probably be in there much longer if he did. Ben says maybe.
Anyway, storyline wise, Dom was only in prison for only what, a few hours? Yeah. So why are they acting like he's been there for fucking years?
Yes, exactly. He's probably only been in there for a weekend. So,
I am a changed man. Prison changes people. Like, Dom, you haven't even been there long enough to flipping experience what prison is even like for you to go through those changes. You.
Yeah.
You flipping pancake.
Ben's busy typing out a whole rant. Meanwhile, he said, Dominic Mysterio stinks. The only way he could have been a changed man is because he sat with someone like T-Bag. Ben's laughing because
I do like the narrative of Dom wanting to be his stepfather Eddie Guerrero. I suppose he's wanting to channel what Eddie was like. I do like that aspect about his character now, but him having spent time in prison and everything else is just absolute nonsense. Where's the logic in that, Triple H?
Find the logic and give it to Triple H or William Regal or whoever.
Where's the logic in this?
That classic rant. Oh, yes. Oh, boy. Ooh. We got something here from Ben. Have the Get Off My TV Awards. The nominees are Elias, Omos, Kip Sabian, Jeff Jarrett, and Mustafa Ali. And the winner by a unanimous vote, Elias. Get him off my fucking TV, Ben says. Maybe we'll see the referee nominees. I think I have a good idea who will be on there. Let's just get on to the meat of the matter, and that is WrestleMania 39 Night 1, which took place at the SoFi Stadium in Inglewood, California on the 1st of April 2023. First match on this card. For the United States Championship, Austin Theory versus John Cena. They start the match. Theory puts in a headlock. Cena shoots him off, gives him a shoulder tackle. They have some technical wrestling. The people chant, "Let's go, Cena. Cena sucks." Cena does a shoot off with a shoulder tackle again. Theory bites John Cena. He takes down John Cena, does a snap suplex for a two count. He taunts, does another snap suplex and taunts. And then Cena reverses the third one. He made a comeback. Theory did a jumping blockbuster, which was nice. He did a drop kick for a two count. They replayed that spot. Went for a second one, but he missed. Cena went for the STF. Theory bit Cena's hand. He mocked the "you can't see me," threw some punches, did a snapmare into a stomp, which was nice. He went for another one, but Cena reversed. Cena went for the AA, but Theory reversed. Theory did a DDT for a two count. They had a 1-2. Theory put in the sleeper. Cena escaped. He hit the five moves of doom. Theory escaped the AA. They had a ref bump. Cena put in the STF. Theory tapped out, but there was no ref to count the four. Theory hits a low blow. Then he hits an A-town down to win. I think that was a good way to put Theory over. And apparently people on social media are mad at the finish. I gave Rassen a 7.5 and Logic a 7. Josh, what do you think about this match?
It did its job. The entire point of this was to have Theory go over Cena. Theory got the win, and it was the right result. There was no other way to book this match other than to have Theory get the win. Yeah. Otherwise, why even have the match? Why have John Cena win? What would John Cena benefit from the win? Hey, another championship reign for John Cena. Another US championship reign. Maybe he can redo the Open Challenge series that he did in 2015. Maybe that would be the benefit, but I don't see that as a benefit. I just see that as hashing out nostalgia just for the sake of it. And that's not what happened, because instead, Austin Theory got the win in a heel way, because he is a heel. And yeah, he is now established, or should be established, as someone to take seriously as a star in the company going forward. People complaining about this match? Well, I disagree personally, because I'm sick and tired of having matches go half an hour, finisher, kick out, finisher, kick out, finisher, kick out, and then you hit a finisher and then you get the win. This was beautiful, because John Cena tried his darndest to hit the attitude adjustment finisher on Austin Theory, but every time he tried, he failed. And the one time that Austin Theory hit his finisher, it was enough to get the win.
Yeah.
That is how it should be done. One finisher for the win. And it helped, because before he actually hit the finisher, he, I believe, hit the low blow, which then set up the finisher for the win. That is a heel being a heel in the way a heel should be. Now, I do question why the tap out, the referee missing the tap out happened, had to happen. I do kind of don't understand why that had to happen. But Theory got the win, and rightfully so. Now, where this goes from here, I don't know. Vince was very high on him. Triple H seems to be somewhatly high on him. So he might be pushed. He might not. I don't know, but time will tell.
All right. And here are Ben's thoughts. Theory got the win, and rightfully so. Good match between the two. Was this the best WrestleMania opener? No, and that's okay. John Cena put him over, and rightfully so. Theory is the future. I gave wrestling a 7 and logic a 6. It's supposed to put Theory over, but I'm not liking him crossing paths with Rey because Rey is not number one contender. And I hope Theory deals with things as U.S. champion, but with Vince back, I doubt it. And then he says, this was a solid match. And yeah, this was a decent match. Nice opener to start the show. So yeah, we get a WWE 2K23 ad, which Josh has now, and I hear he's enjoying it quite a bit. And
I will admit, this is the best version of a 2K produced WWE game that they've ever done. And that is saying a lot, because they've done 2K15 all the way to 2K23 now, and this one is the best one they've done yet. If they can go forward and actually put in improvements to the gameplay itself, which they kind of showed some glimpses of within this version of the game, then I will be a happy man, because I've been complaining for the past 10 plus years that the gameplay is the same as it always has been. This year, I did notice a few signs of improvement, so hopefully 2K24, 5, whatever the next game is going to be called, will have some of those improvements. I am hoping. Time will tell.
All right, yeah. And then we get an Alpha Academy Snickers ad. Shoosh! I've kind of enjoyed doing that. Ben doesn't like it that much, but yeah.
Mom! You told me everybody sleeps with a nightlight. You're not hungry when you're not you. Snickers, get some nuts. How embarrassing must that have been, eh, for Chad Gable? Oh, my God.
Oh, Ben's typing something about him. I said, Chad Gable, get off my TV.
I disagree. I really like Chad. He's a very good wrestler. You know, when Kurt Angle returned in 2017,
I think.
Yes, on the Raw after WrestleMania 33, when he made his return, I was hoping that he would be Chad Gable's manager. But that never happened, because they didn't see the sense in that.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah. Moving on.
Yeah, Ben says Chad Gable's a good wrestler, but his gimmick is horrendous. So that's why he wants him to get off TV.
Yeah. Okay.
And
okay.
Speaking of get off TV, we have the second match. Ricochet and Braun Strowman still employed versus Alpha Academy consisting of Chad Gable still employed and Otis still employed versus Street Profits. Unfortunately, I hate to say this, still employed because they're not really being booked that great. Versus Viking Raiders consisting of Eric and Ivar with Sarah Logan. Gave this match wrestling 0, logic 0. Completely 0 rating for this. I didn't bother watching this. Josh, do you have any thoughts? I doubt you do.
I could complain about the rules not being followed, but I'm sick and tired of saying that, so I don't really have anything else to say except I think the Viking Raiders should have got the win.
Yeah.
That's all I'm going to say. I think they should have won this match. They're the ones who should be getting a push, but I digress.
Yeah, why does this need to be on WrestleMania? Ben says Viking Raiders should have won, but this is getting a zero rating. Another zero rating from Ben as well. So I guess we all get this.
Yeah, I would give this a zero based on the rules not being followed. But what's new? What is new when that happens? Eh?
Oh, unanimous zero rating from this. Now for the third match, which I also skipped. I had to skip a Seth Rollins match. Yeah, but it was Seth Rollins versus Logan Paul, who's still employed. I gave Rassen a zero and Logic a zero. This is a zero-rated match. Logan Paul, please get out of here. And apparently now KSI came in dressed up as a prime drink.
Yes.
So that there was that whole thing.
Logan, he made his entrance on a zip line.
Yeah, he did.
Shades of Shawn Michaels from WrestleMania 12. The boyhood dream has come true! Except not for Logan Paul. Because fuck Logan Paul. Yeah. I will say about this match, and this might come as a shock, but Logan is a decent wrestler. It's just him as a person I don't really connect with. Seth got the win, so thank you for giving Seth the win. Seth needed this win, especially after the past year of how he got booked. Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But yeah, Seth got the win. And unfortunately, this feud might continue because the rumors are Logan has re-signed.
Come on.
Time will tell.
So. Yeah, and here's Ben's thoughts. Logan Paul, get off TV. KSI, get off TV. KSI is a prime drink. I yelled at the top of my lungs. Get the fuck off my TV, KSI. We need CSI to arrest Logan Paul because he has been fucking changing the channel heat. Seth Rollins beat his ass and good. And yeah, we skipped this match. Now the next match, a trios match, which I kind of have a big problem with. WWE Women's Tag Team Champions Becky Lynch and Lita and Trish Stratus versus Bayley and Damage Control, which is Dakota Kai and Io Sky. My big problem with this, why did this have to be a trios match? I'd have been fine with just Bayley and Becky, which they did have, but they had it on a random ass episode of Raw in December. This match would have been better off on a special episode of Raw. This would have been better off on Raw's 30. Why couldn't we just have Bayley versus Becky on their own? That would have been a great match. This match wasn't bad. They attacked each other before the bell. Becky and Dakota Kai start the match. Becky goes for a manhandle slam, but Kai escapes. EO Sky made a description. Kai hit a scorpion kick, which was nice. Bayley made a tag. EO made a tag after that. They beat up Becky. EO Sky got a two count. She did a nice missile drop kick for a two count. They replayed that spot. Bayley and Kai make the tag. They triple team on Becky and Kai for a two count. Dakota Kai beats up Becky for a two count. Bailey makes a tag. Becky sent Bailey to ringside. Meanwhile, Dakota Kai made a tag. Becky kicked it down. Damage control stopped Becky from tagging out. And then Io Sky made a tag. Lita made a lukewarm tag. If you don't know already, we rate tags from freezing cold to flaming hot. And this was kind of in the middle. A lukewarm tag. It was she hits scissors EO into the corner, does a front Russian leg sweep for two count, does Lita. She gets on a turnbuckle. Dakota Kai hits a step up in Siguri from the back. The referee didn't see. EO Sky gets a two count. Dakota Kai and Bailey make tags. My gosh, there's so many. They triple thrust kick. I don't know who they did it on. Bailey got a two count. I guess on Lita. Bailey kicked Lita in the corner. Yeah. Damage control taunts. EO Sky made the tag. Did a sleeper near the rolls, near the ropes. And they taunted. Dakota Kai made a tag. She choked Lita for, why do I keep saying Lita? Lita for a two count. Bailey and EO Sky makes a tag. They go for a double team, but Lita reverses with a double DDT. Trish makes a room temperature tag. She gets a two count. They have a big fight at ringside. Trish hits a spine buster for a two count. Lita makes an attack. They do kind of a weird double team. It was kind of a botch. Becky made a tag, did an assisted leg drop, put in the disarmer. Bailey broke up the submission. Bailey made a tag. They had a 1-2. Bailey did a sliding clubbing blow to the back. Becky hit a back suplex. They did a ref bump. Bailey hit the rose plant. They went for the pin, but Lita broke up the pin. There's multiple women in the ring. They spill onto ringside. EO hits a moonsault. They all lay down selling. They replayed that spot, and after that, they got back in the ring before the count out. They made quick tags. Then they all had a 3-6, you know, because 1-2 is two people, 2-4 is two tag teams punching each other, and 3 is like a whole trio punching each other. Two trios punching each other. So, yeah. Anyway, Lita hit the twist of fate on EO Sky. She hit the Lita salt on EO Sky and Dakota Kai. Becky Lynch did a avalanche Manhattan slam on Bailey for the win. I gave Rasen 7.75 and Logic a 5. Before I ask you, Josh, what were your thoughts? Ben says that Becky and Bailey Lynch, had a little typo there. Bailey and Becky Lynch should have been at WrestleMania in 3 stages of hell match. They should have ended this miserable feud. And most importantly, Becky Lynch should have beaten Bailey clean without damage control. Becky Lynch would win clean by default because damage control is on Bailey's side. He thought it was okay. He gave Rasen 6 and Logic 1. That's the best he can give. Damage control should have had an angle after this match where they blame Bailey and most importantly, breakup. I'm sick of them being treated like jobbers. What did you think about this match, Josh?
Well, I'm not particularly a fan of it. And Ben, I still can't hear you, so it doesn't matter what you're trying to say. We can't hear you, buddy. But yeah, this match, it shouldn't have happened. The booking didn't really dictate this to happen in a logical way.
And sorry to cut you off. And anyway, it wasn't building up. Did we see that Trish Stratus and Lita were going to be in the match. It didn't have to be a trios match. It could have been just a single match or a three stages of hell match that Ben suggested. Because that's where it was going. I'd hoped it would have been a triple threat match against Bianca Belair for the Raw Women's title. But I guess we didn't get that. We will get to Bianca Belair next week. I have a big problem with what happened. But anyway, Josh, back to your thoughts.
Yeah, I'll just say this quick. I've not liked this feud at all. Like, zero. I would rate Becky's return at SummerSlam last July of 2022, all the way to right now, this second in time, I would rate everything she's done, including her partners, Dakota Kai and Io Sky, a 0 out of 10. The group died about a week, or if not the same week, they got introduced. They never made any sense to be paired up anyway to begin with. It was so random. And then they didn't put any effort into making the group make sense. They were supposed to be putting the women's division in order, right? They were supposed to put some control to the division in the way that they see it and the way that they think it should be. And yet that never even happened. They didn't do anything to really cement what their gimmick was supposed to be about. They lost at like 60% or so of the time, although my maths isn't very good, so I'm just assuming here that it's about 60% if not 70% of the time that they lost. Because the last time I said this, I got proven wrong with the Finn Balor and the Judgment Day situation. But Bayley, you mentioned that you wanted to see them at Raw is 30, or, you know, Raw is XXX, as they promoted it as. But they used their segment at Raw is 30 in the steel cage to build to a steel cage match, even though the steel cage was already there at the ready for them to have the match then. But they instead chose, because they didn't have enough time apparently, to do a beatdown segment to build to a steel cage match, which ended up being a bad steel cage match that nobody really wanted to see to begin with, based on how they poorly built up to it. And then Lita came back. She became the tag team champions with Becky Lynch out of nowhere. And now we are expected to believe that they are something to like. What is going on? Trish Stratus came back, and then the rumors was she was going to turn heel to set up a feud with Becky Lynch, but that hasn't happened. So what was the point? What was the point of any of this? Triple H does not know how to book women. I don't understand that, because in NXT, he actually treated them like they've been matted. So why, since he took control, has he gone in reverse with the women? Why? Why doesn't he understand good booking with the women? I don't understand. He Like, Bianca has been booked absolute rubbish. Alexa Bliss has been booked rubbish. Asuka, she came back at the Royal Rumble with a new sort of chapter in her character, and yet she's booked to flipping. Right. Whoa, do you remember in 2020 when Shayna Baszler won the Elimination Chamber
just to lose to Becky Lynch? I'm sure you get the point. Yes. Yes, definitely.
Fucking hell.
I will never forgive them for that. Well, the way they did Shayna Baszler. I was so excited because they were going to continue her dominance that she had in NXT. She held that women's title for like almost 2 years. Then they seemed to continue that when she came to Raw. She bit Becky Lynch. She beat up everybody and won the chamber. And then at WrestleMania, she lost. Becky Lynch beat her, and Becky Lynch wanted to put over Shayna Baszler. And I'm like, why? I'll get to Asuka tomorrow. I have
No. And just to your point there, WrestleMania 36, Becky was pregnant at the same time.
Why was she even wrestling?
Why? And then the Money in the Bank match was for the Women's Championship, but then they advertised it as a Money in the Bank match. Asuka came out on Raw just to be given the flipping championship. As a Money in the Bank match when it was even for the Money in the Bank. It's a fuck Triple H.
That was Vince, but yeah. My gosh, like, why would you build up Shayna Baszler and have her get beaten by a pregnant Becky Lynch, who ended up giving it to Asuka anyway the following month? Oh, this company.
And then why bring back Asuka at the Royal Rumble in the way that they did? Give her the Elimination Chamber win in the way that they did, just to then have her lose to Bianca. Bianca has had the Raw Women's Championship for a full year now. Yeah. She should have lost already.
Yeah, and turn heel, maybe.
Yes! Yeah, like... Whoa. Chill. Breathe. God. Anyway, I'm sure there are other matches.
Yeah, before we move on, Ben just wants to add on something. There was no point to whatever Josh you said, and there's no reason why Damage Control should be a fucking stable. And then he said, once again, who writes this? I think we have a good idea who writes this. Yeah, it's Vince or Triple H and a bunch of dumbass writers who I've said many times should be fired. But anyways, now we have the next match. Ben's favorite wrestler, Dominic Mysterio, the ex-con, Fox River alumni or wherever he spent time, versus his father, Rey Mysterio. They start the match. They locked up. Dominic taunted. They locked up again. Dom put in the waist lock. Rey sent Dom to ringside. They shoved each other. Rey did a head scissors. And this match was sponsored by Cinnamon Toast Crunch, which I think you and Ben spoke about the other day, Josh. Dominic slapped Rey Mysterio. Rey sent Dom into the corner. He whipped Dom with a belt as if he was a little kid. Dominic left the ring. He splashed his sister with water. They got back in the ring. He did a springboard backsplash for a two count. Or a springboard swanton, I think. They replayed the Dominic throwing water at his sister, Aaliyah. Oh, there's a belt that Josh is holding. don't know if he intends to use it on anyone. Well, he's a pacifist, so I doubt he would. Dom taunts. Rey makes a comeback. Dom does a deep arm drag. Hits a Michinoku driver for a two count. He hanged Rey over the top rope. Talks shit to his mom, Angie. Then Angie slaps him. Good. They got back in the ring. Rey did a senton. Did a springboard crossbody for a two count. They replayed Angie slapping Dom. Rey hit a code red for a near fall. Too many code reds in wrestling these days, by the way. Damian Priest and Finn Balor at ringside. Dominic threw his dad head first into the corner. Rey basically no-sold it and kicked out at two. That was a problem that I had. Dom did a one amigo suplex. Rey hit the 619. Finn Balor made a distraction. And then Priest pulled Rey off the turnbuckle. Dominic did a hammer throw. They spilled on the ringside. Legado del Fantasma came to Rey's aid. Dominic hit a nice lariat. He did a catapult. Then he hit the 619. Then a frog splash for a two count. They replayed that spot. Dom exposed the turnbuckle. He took a chain. Then Bad Bunny, who was on Spanish commentary, took the chain away. And then Rey hit a 619 and a splash for the win. And then Rey, his wife Angie, and his daughter Aaliyah hugged it out. And Judgment Day retreated. Normally, as this is another Judgment Day loss, I would get mad at this. But I'll excuse it because, you know, it was justified. Rey goes over and... it's wholesome, and I gave Rassin an 8 and Logic a 7. While Ben types out his thoughts, Josh, what do you think about this match?
Rey won, good, the right result. Dominic will get the win against his father at Backlash, probably in a tag team match. It might be Rey and Bad Bunny against Dominic and Damien.
Damien Priest. We will review Backlash. That's happening in Puerto Rico. We will review that. And that's nice that they're having Bad Bunny, we've actually come to like Bad Bunny, unlike Logan Paul. Who's get off my TV. Rey and Dominic had a solid match. This was good, Ben said. I gave Rassin an 8 and Logic a 7. This was fun. Rey finally beat Dominic. And no, Josh, I don't think Dominic should get any fucking wins. That's what Ben said. I don't know if Josh, you have anything to respond to that.
I think Dom should get a few wins, obviously. Otherwise, this feud would end right here, right now. So,
yeah.
Which I wouldn't complain if this feud came to an end right here, right now. But obviously, they are building up to a tag match at Backlash. and probably a few other matches in the months to come. So, yeah. Look, as long as this helps Dom and it establishes him as someone to take notice of, then sure. But Dom's already lost on me since he turned heel, so I don't give a damn anyway.
Yeah. And Ben has a response here. It should have ended a long time ago, Josh, this feud. It kept going on Raw. They've been feuding since October. And Josh has nothing to say except a little shrug. We have the next match for the SmackDown Women's Championship. Charlotte Flair, the champion, versus Rhea Ripley, the challenger. And
yes, yeah. Yes,
yeah,
this was a very good match.
Yeah,
oh my god, 5 stars.
Oh, all the damn. Josh gave that a high rating, and Ben as well. He said this was a great match. Yeah, 5 stars he's trying to say there, but the green screen's blocking it. This is their 5th match. They had a match at Mania 36. They had a match at Money in the Bank 20. Oh, no, wait. Oh, what? They had 4 matches before this, and one of them was a random-ass match on Raw, which got 5 out of 10 from most people. I think maybe Ben... Oh, no. Nah.
They had a triple threat match at NXT TakeOver In Your House with Io Shirai at the time.
Yeah. Yeah, that... I don't even want to talk about the first time they came together. Because, you know, Rhea Ripley never really recovered from that. And it took her coming to the main roster to fully recover. And now she... Yeah, we'll talk about that just now. By the way, one of Ben's favorite referees, Jessica Carr, refereed this match. And it was actually quite wholesome. Because it was all women in the ring. The announcer was a woman, the referee was a woman, and there were 2 women wrestling each other for a women's world title. So yeah, that was good for women's wrestling. So yeah, they start the match, they had a stare down, they locked up, they had a weird shoulder tackle spot. Charlotte did a shoulder tackle. She sent Rhea to ringside. Rhea got back in the ring. She talked shit. They had a 1-2 shoulder rams in the corner by Rhea. Charlotte hits a big boot from the apron. Knocks some. By the way, where our minus points from this was that Charlotte was a baby face. She was so awkward as a baby face. She got no reaction, because she's made to be a heel. We're used to her being a heel most of the time. So yeah, that was kind of weird. Now back to the match. Charlotte hit a crossbody. Rhea did an elbow strike. Charlotte kicked Rhea. Rhea slammed Charlotte into the corner. Did some kicks. She yanked Charlotte into the corner, which was quite nasty. They replayed that spot, and there I said Charlotte is so awkward as a baby face. I found it so unnatural. And then Rhea put Charlotte in what Graves called a body lock. She taunted. Charlotte escaped. She did a roll up for a 2 count. Rhea did 3 forearms to the back, and then Charlotte on the last one, she loudly called the spot, and she said, "One more, one more." And you could hear that on the mic that they put in the ring. Rhea Ripley hit a German suplex with a release for a two count. She talked shit and said, "How much does this title mean to you? Huh?" Charlotte hits a spinning back elbow, did a lackluster comeback, did chops. She beat up Rhea. The people alternated, "Let's go, Rhea, let's go, Charlotte," and that stuff. Rhea Ripley countered a crossbody from Charlotte Flair, but then Charlotte countered Rhea's riptide with a DDT for a near fall, which was nice. They replayed that spot. Rhea put in the inside cradle pin for a two count. Both women big booted each other simultaneously, and they laid down selling. They replayed that spot. They had a kneeling 1-2. Charlotte hit an exploder. They laid down selling, and then Charlotte did a trademark kip up. Rhea hit a botched avalanche German off the top rope because Charlotte flipped and she fell on her face. Charlotte hit a natural selection for a near fall. Rhea Ripley left the ring. They got back in the ring. She slammed Charlotte for a near fall. They replayed the steel step spot, which I forgot to mention. Rhea Ripley taunted. Charlotte hit a German. And then Rhea Ripley hit a German, but Charlotte flipped again and almost broke her face. She kind of fucked up her nose a bit. Then she hit the big boot for a two count. They replayed that spot. Charlotte hit a moonsault on Rhea at ringside. Rhea Ripley did a headbutt and a riptide for a near fall. And the people she got a huge reaction from that. They replayed that spot. Rhea Ripley was frustrated. She put in the clover leaf, but Charlotte got a rope break. Charlotte hit a spear for a near fall. They replayed that spot. And then they had a 1-2, and that was the best 1-2 I've probably seen ever reviewing wrestling for these past 2 years. 2.5 years, maybe. Charlotte put in the figure four. Rhea Ripley immediately got a rope break. They had a struggle at the turnbuckle. Rhea Ripley slammed Charlotte's head against the ring post, and then she did an avalanche riptide for the win. And now she's the new SmackDown Women's Champion. I'm so happy for Rhea Ripley that she finally got justice against Charlotte Flair. This is a great match, a nice match. Oh, not to end the show, because there's still a match after this. I gave wrestling an 8.5 and logic a 9. What did you think about this match, Josh?
Well, I've already given it a enthusiastic 5-star rating.
Okay, yeah. That's
Charlotte, I agree. Charlotte is a natural heel. The way her body language is a heel. The way she speaks is a heel. She just comes off as a heel so naturally that her being a face is so off-putting, because it's just so disingenuous to how she actually is as a character, that I can understand why you would have difficulty believing in her as a face, Abel. Now, Two things. The slogan for WrestleMania 23, and this does tie in to this here, so don't worry. The slogan of WrestleMania 23 was "All Grown Up." I feel that this match was exactly that. 3 years ago, compared to now, Rhea has grown up as a performer in this business. To the point she is now established as the main event star of the company. She is all grown up, as the slogan was for WrestleMania 23. That slogan fits here very nicely for this match, I believe. And point number two, I recall a big moment in NXT in, I think, December 2019, I think, when Rhea Ripley beat Shayna Baszler to become the NXT Women's Champion. And the way she did it is the exact way this match ended. With the I think it's the Riptide bomb off the top rope, off the top turnbuckle for the three count and the win. The way she beat Shayna Baszler to become the NXT Women's Champion is the same way she beat Charlotte Flair here to become the SmackDown Women's Champion. I thought that was a nice link to the way she wins her championships, in a sense. I thought that was nice. And yeah, I've already said that this is a 5-star match, so I don't need to go into that. Now where this leads, I don't know. Hopefully something that I can get attached to in a positive way, but we'll see. Now, when Charlotte lost and she was sitting at ringside smiling, by the way, I got the vibe that she was either going to retire and she was smiling off character, smiling because of the success that Rhea has now have is now having.
That's what I was thinking. She was probably smiling because she was happy for Rhea Ripley and so proud of her. And
yes,
kind of breaking character. I'll excuse it because it was wholesome.
And I don't know if that was supposed to be caught by the camera or if that was deliberate or not, but that is the vibe that I was getting, that Charlotte was, you know, showing her pleasant side for Rhea getting the win. And also I thought that Charlotte was going to announce her retirement or something. That hasn't happened, so that's probably not going to happen. This was a very, very good match. I was very surprised, even though I don't know why I would be surprised, considering the talent of performers in the ring there between them. This was probably the best match of night one, in my opinion. And yeah, I look forward to see how this goes. Well, yeah. I say I look forward, but knowing how the booking is, I'm not really looking forward, but I'm sure you get my point.
Yeah. So. Ben says that this was a great match. He gave this match wrestling 8 and logic a 7. Good match between the two, and Rhea Ripley deserved to win. We're going to go to the final match of night one, and not the main event of night one, for our sake, and because we risk Josh going off on us. For the Undisputed Tag Team Championships, the Usos, Jimmy and Jay, the champions, versus Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn, which Ben says they're not a real tag team, but yeah. Sami Zayn and Jimmy start. Jay makes a tag. He locks up with Sami Zayn. Jay, hits a shoulder tackle, does the We The Ones pose, you know, his finger pointing up in the air. They lock up again. Sami Zayn grounds and pounds Jay. He throws some punches. Jimmy makes a blind tag. Jay and Sami Zayn fight at ringside. Jay tags back in. He does a dive. He taunts Sami Zayn. Does a suplex at ringside. They get back in the ring. Throws a punch. He beats down on Sami Zayn. Jimmy hits a big boot behind the ref's back. They replayed that big boot. Jay puts in a leg lock. Jimmy makes a tag and kicks Sami Zayn. Takes out Kevin Owens. Jay makes a tag. They double team for a two count. Jay pulls the hair of Sami Zayn. Puts in a side headlock. Sami Zayn does a kick. He expels the Usos from the ring. Kale makes a hot tag. Does a frog splash on Jay for a near fall. They replayed that spot. Kevin Owens goes for the stunner, but then Jey Uso countered with a nice neck breaker. That gets a two count. Jimmy makes a tag. Kevin Owens does a swanton on Jey Uso. Jimmy Uso hits an Uso splash on Kevin Owens for a two count. Kevin Owens does a super kick on Jimmy. Does a cannonball. They're on the top rope. Jay tries to knock him down, but Sami Zayn hits a brain buster on Jay on the apron. Kevin Owens hits a swanton on Jimmy for a two count. Come on. They replayed the brain buster and the swanton. Meanwhile, Sami Zayn tagged. You couldn't see it because of the replay. So good thing I noticed that. He did a Uso splash on Jimmy for a near fall. They replayed that spot. People chanted, ole, 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 ole. Sami Zayn went for the Blue Thunder Bomb, but Jimmy reversed. Jimmy super kicked Kevin Owens. Jimmy reversed another Blue Thunder Bomb. Jey Uso made a tag. Sami Zayn hit the Blue Thunder Bomb, but Jay hit a thrust kick, did a drop kick for a two count, which was nice. They replayed that spot. Jey Uso taunted Sami Zayn. You hear that shit? He took off his shirt and threw it on Sami Zayn. Jimmy makes a tag. Uso do a super kick party on Sami Zayn. KO makes a pin break. Jay super kicks Kevin Owens. Jay makes a tag. He talks shit to Sami Zayn. The Usos both super kick Sami Zayn for a two count. Jimmy makes a tag. They do a double super kick again for a two count. Jay makes a tag. The Usos go for 1D, but Kevin Owens pulls Jimmy out of the ring. Sami rolls up Jay for a two count. Kevin Owens beats up Jimmy at ringside. Tried to powerbomb Jimmy on the Spanish announce desk, but Jay dropped him. The Usos do a double powerbomb on the English announce desk, and Josh now has a Lion King background. The moon. Ben trying to do that thing there. Enough about the Lion King and back to Usos versus Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. They replayed the double powerbomb. They got back in the ring. Usos hit a 1D on Sami Zayn for a near fall. Sami Zayn is the first to kick out of the 1D. Jay was frustrated.
You just won't quit, won't you? Why won't you quit? I called you my brother.
And then he slaps Sammy beat up Sami Zayn in the corner. Gives him a hell of a kick. He talked more shit. And then Sami Zayn hit an exploder. They replayed that spot. And then KO was like, come on, man. Tag me. And then KO made a hell hot tag. A flaming hot tag. KO and Sami Zayn did a double team for a near fall. Both teams did a stare down. They had a 2-4. The Usos super... Kevin Owens super kick both the Usos. The Usos did a super kick party on KO. They both took out Sami Zayn. They both Uso splashed Kevin Owens for a near fall. Jimmy made the tag. They did a double super kick again on Kevin Owens. Sami Zayn pulls Jimmy out of the ring. Then KO hit a superplex. He did that one that Cesaro did back in January 2021. He had a match with Bryan Danielson. He had a wow, both those guys on that match on SmackDown, they're both in AEW now. Ain't that crazy to think about? KO hit a nice superplex. Sami Zayn made a tag. He stared down Jey Uso. Gave him two hell of a kicks. Jimmy tried to stop the third one, but then KO hit a stunner. Then Sami hit the third hell of a kick to win the WWE Undisputed Tag Team titles for him and Kevin Owens. I thought this was a great match. It's a very good match. It was good that Josh is shaking his head. There are definitely some problems. I'm happy for Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. I gave Rassen a 9 and Logic an 8. I'll give Ben's thoughts quickly. He gave this match Rassen 7 and Logic 6. The reason is that this match is not higher than a 7 is because we had the Usos title raid ended by two main event caliber guys who are not and still not are not a tag team. If they were tag team, they are at least a tag team in life. I do like the direction they are going in, but the entire thing was a good match. Don't get me wrong. This is good, but again, they lost to Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. Sami Zayn went from the main event of the last pay-per-view to the tag team titles. Talk about a drop down. Don't get me wrong. I like that Sami and KO are champions, but the way that it happened was unnecessary. Good match, though. Those are Ben's thoughts on this match. What do you think about this match, Josh?
Zero out of 10.
Oh!
For both the logic and the wrestling.
Oh, damn! Zero rating this, from Josh.
This match never should have even happened to begin with.
Oh, damn.
And I will say this now. Oh, super kick, second tire of it. Stop the super kicks. Shawn Michaels isn't even in his grave and he should be rolling over at the amount of them. Fucking hell, I'm sick of the super kick party. Stop it. This match never should have happened. The entire story is absolute bullshit. So 0-0-0-0-0-0-0-0-0.
Oh, damn. Oh, gave this. Oh.
I don't give a shit if Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens won. I don't give a fucking shit. This storyline has been bullshit for several months. Several months. This match never, ever, ever should have happened on this fucking pay-per-view. 0 out of 10. Fuck you, Triple H. Fuck you, Vince McMahon. And fuck this company. I'm out.
Damn. Well, that was quite a rant from Josh. Oh, boy. Oh. And yeah.
Vince, it's not the main event, so shut up speaking about it being the main event. It's not. I don't care how many people want to flip and say it is. It's not.
Well, we didn't say that it was the main event, and Josh, Ben put 3 laughing emojis when he sent me. Yeah, because he found this rant to be quite funny. Oh, boy, that was quite wow. Oh, well, it wasn't completely unexpected, but it was surprising. Kind of contradict myself, so I'll explain. I did not expect that Josh wouldn't be happy with this. Because he did kind of say that if this match happens, he will get angry. I think it was at the Elimination Chamber review that he said that this match shouldn't happen. But now I have to wait for Ben before I can close this episode, because he's still typing right now. In the meanwhile, you can check out The Mysteries of Life, Season 3, Episode 1, which just dropped today, by the way, on Friday. That was dropped. It's Sunday today when you guys hear this. Happy Easter, by the way. And before we go, we've got the referees awards of the Get Off My TV awards of the month of March 2023 in terms of referees. And Josh is showing there The Mysteries of Life, and the nominees are Rick Knox, Stefan Smith, Paul Turner, Sean Bennett, and Jessica Carr. Another unanimous vote. Stefan Smith wins. Get him off my TV, says Ben. My gosh. Ben cannot stand Stefan Smith. That's a whole thing. He absolutely cannot stand Stefan Smith. So, hope you guys enjoy this episode. Thank you guys for listening or watching this episode. Even though with Ben's inconvenience, you couldn't hear him. Ben's quickly typing something. But, as I said, he says there will hopefully be better audio for night 2 next week. But in the meantime, you can check out the roundups. There are no roundups this week because we still have to finish reviewing night 2 of WrestleMania. But there is Season 3, Episode 1 of The Mysteries of Life, and Overload 3 of Certified Bangers, which will be out by the time you hear this. We will see you guys next week for night 2 of WrestleMania 39. But until then, on behalf of Ben Charles, this is Carbonator and Josh Jenkins. Signing out.